Auction Ready, How to Buy Property at Auction Even Though You're Scared Shitless. Written by Veronica Morgan, narrated by Veronica Morgan. I'll guide you on how to escape costly first-time buying mistakes. Decipher property price guides and pinpoint their real value. How to protect yourself against sly agent tactics, tricks and techniques. How to set a realistic budget and be confident that you won't overpay. You'll understand how auctioneers influence people to bid above their limit. And most importantly, you'll be able to secure your dream home or investment property with the least amount of stress and wasted time and without being absolutely scared shitless. Chapter 1. This audiobook is called Auction Ready, How to Master Auctions and Bid Like a Pro by yours truly, Veronica Morgan. It's almost 10 a.m. on a Saturday and the auction is about to start. You adjust your sunglasses in the morning glare and scull the last dregs of the free coffee from the coffee cart that's now closing up shop. You've got a blinding headache from one too many reds last night, and glancing at your partner, you see that their lips are set in a firm line. They're just as hungover as you are and not happy to be there. Both still smarting from the disappointment of missing out on your dream house the previous week. Clinging to your leg, your youngest child starts whining about Peppa Pig. The babysitter cancelled at the last minute, but rather than not attend, you decided to pack everyone into the car anyway. The murmuring crowd falls silent as the auctioneer takes up his position, rolled up contract in hand. As he begins his spiel, you start to sweat and feel your partner tense beside you. It's been a tough few months and you're both exhausted. This house isn't what you'd imagined buying when you first started the process, but you're here now, you paid for the building and pest inspection, the conveyancer, and you're registered to bid. You feel like the agents are watching you, willing you to put your hand up. Your daughter tightens her grip and her voice goes up an octave, and your partner bundles the child off to the side away from the auction. The auctioneer suggests a number right at the top of your price range and the number rings in your ears, making you question the more reasonable figure that you had been imagining. Someone on your left raises their hand and confidently announces a number even higher. They look calm, relaxed even, they're smiling. Suddenly, you feel gripped by a fear of missing out. You raise your hand and say a number above your maximum. Your partner's head whips around and they try to motion towards you while keeping hold of your child, but the damage is done. The auctioneer looks pleased. The confident person on your left doesn't respond. The auctioneer keeps fishing, but no one else bites. You glance around. The auctioneer seems to be winding up. Surely someone else will chime in, but no. The gavel falls and the house is yours. The confident would-be buyer who backed out before your bid claps along with everyone else and then strolls off down the street without a care in the world. How are they so calm? Why did they back out? What do they know that I don't? Questions whiz through your mind, but it's time to head inside and sign the contract. Why buy a property? Why put yourself through all the deprivation of saving up a deposit? The heartache when you miss out on your dream home. The dejection you feel when you know you're going to have to move away from where you really want to live or settle for a shoebox in order to stay within a 30-minute commute to work. Is it really worth it? Before I attempt to answer this for you, try fast-forwarding your life 40 years. Imagine retiring and not owning your own home. Imagine living on the pension and having to pay rent. And if you're a self-funded retiree, imagine having to pay rent every week out of your diminishing superannuation. Imagine having to move in with your kids and losing your independence. Sounds dramatic, but if you get a firm footing on the property ladder when you are young, you will have a much more comfortable life than you will if you don't. Of course, that doesn't mean that buying just any old property will do, but that's a topic for my next book. For now, keep listening, for I have a few tips coming up to help you avoid costly mistakes. Property can be a very good investment for two reasons. One, compound growth, and two, leverage. Compound growth means that the value grows exponentially, like a snowball gets bigger and bigger as it rolls down a hill. A good property in a good location will, over time, make more money than you can save. When you add leverage, that's a financial term for borrowing money, you have more skin in the game, like having a bigger snowball in the first place. There's more surface area and it grows even faster as it gets bigger. In Australia, you also have a great tax advantage in owning and living in your own home. That increase in value, called capital growth, is tax-free. When you sell, you get to keep it all, which will be particularly handy when you want to upgrade. The advantages of buying a home are more than simply financial, they're emotional and psychological. For me, owning my own home gives me a sense of stability, of place, of security. It gives our kids somewhere to bed down memories, establish traditions, a place where they belong. We can decorate the way we want, hang pictures, paint, dig up the garden, install solar panels. And when we make smart decisions, we accumulate wealth in our homes and, over time, this equity gives us options and freedom. So if you're looking to make the leap, invest your money wisely and put down roots, buying a house is the best way forward. And here's a short history of home ownership in Australia. The Great Australian Dream is alive and well, but it has changed over the past decades, and I believe it's on the cusp of changing again. That said, there is a vast array of property in this country, and one person's castle is another one's prison. For instance, I live in the inner city. I can't imagine not being able to walk everywhere and have every convenience on my doorstep. My brother, on the other hand, hates traffic and crowds. Not that I love them. He headed to the country as soon as he could and avoids coming into the city like the plague. Neither of us enjoyed living in suburbia, yet the vast majority of Sydneysiders will beg to differ. Our sister, on the other hand, left Australia altogether and is raising her young boys in an apartment in a historic town in Italy. We Australians believe in our indelible right to own our own home, and much has been made of this in popular culture. Ever seen that classic film The Castle or the more kitschy Emeruo? My parents are baby boomers and they strive to own a quarter acre block in suburbia. We grew up in a street with similar style houses, all built in the 60s and 70s. We spent our childhood outdoors in huge backyards, and if you're really lucky, you had an above ground pool. And we played footy with the neighbours' kids on the nature strip. In the 80s, the subdivisions continued and urban sprawl began overtaking the food bowls in the outskirts of our cities. The blocks were getting smaller, the houses growing larger. Kids spent more time indoors watching colour TV and playing Space Invaders. It's even worse now with personal devices. In the cities, from where all the suburbanites had fled in the 50s and 60s, the process of gentrification began as some people started to value a shorter commute and the period charm of Victorian terraces and workers' cottages. Land in our ever-expanding cities seems to be in endless supply. Did you know that Melbourne is now 100 kilometres wide? And new suburbs with never-before-heard-of names entice first home buyers with their shiny house and land packages. In the meantime, house prices in the inner rings of our cities have climbed to stratospheric heights because land is scarce. Affordability is the word on everybody's lips, especially our politicians. Most of them are only referring to first home buyers, but in reality, the issue extends to renters as well. The purpose of this book is not to discuss nor pose solutions to the affordability crisis, but we do need to acknowledge that it's there. It's another reason to buy your own home if you can, because in future decades, more and more people will be priced out of home ownership in our cities. You will ensure your financial future if you buy well now. This challenge will change the way we live. In fact, it already has. Families are starting to embrace apartment living, and a handful of enlightened developers are catering for multi-generational living. If we look to global cities like New York, London, Hong Kong, Milan, Paris, for example, the majority of parents rear their children, and often a dog, in an apartment. In my view, it's the way of the future for our cities as well. I just wish we also constructed buildings designed to last hundreds of years. Once again, a topic for another book. Now, one thing an apartment offers is more flexibility. They are easier to lock up and leave, they don't need as much maintenance as a house, and they are easier to rent out as long as they're in the right location. Generally, you get a better yield, that's a higher ratio of rent to property value. Millennials tell me they don't want to be tied down by a home, they want to be free to relocate and work anywhere in the world. Owning an apartment can facilitate this more than a house can. I'm Gen X. So if you're a Gen Y reading this, I hope you don't blame me if you feel you can't afford a home. You've probably heard it all before. But we had our challenges too. Interest rates were ridiculously high. So we could save up a deposit easily enough, but we could barely afford to repay the mortgage when we got it. I know your biggest challenge is to save the deposit. Recent data shows that if you're single, it will take you 12 years in Sydney and 9 years in Melbourne to save enough to buy your first home. But once you do, the worst is over, and you'll never have to save like that again. As long as you don't waste it, but more on that later. It's worth the sacrifices. Stay living with your parents, take a second job, be frugal, don't spend $60,000 on your wedding, travel later. Now, of course, if you don't.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.